want to do over the next 40 minutes or so is get a bit of a sense of how you've got there, what your business does, and how to be an entrepreneur these days in Africa, which, as you were hearing this morning, has really been seen or is being seen by many as the great opportunity of the decades ahead. So, first of all, I have to ask you, is it true that you're the richest man in Africa?
Most likely, yes, because of the, when you look at our market cap and investment that we have in the stock market, I think so.
But you said, you quoted as saying in The Economist that you wanted to be the most successful in the world, so not only Africa, so clearly you have ambitions for much wider horizons than that. But I'd like to know how you got to this point. So tell your story. Where did you begin in business?
Well, you know, thank you very much, Daniel. I think, well, you know, I started up in 1978 by just being trading, you know, after going back to Nigeria from school. And when I started, actually, you know, it was just the mere trading, you know, because at that time, apparently, I started with cement, which, you know, if you remember, Nigeria had made quite a substantial amount of money in the early 70s. And we had small infrastructure, small ports, and I remember at that time we had about 460 ships waiting to berth in a place where we had only about 40 berths. And, you know, it was very chaotic. So when I started, my grandfather gave me the capital of about 500,000 as a loan to be paid over 2 years.
Max
US
dollar. Well, yeah, the naira was very strong. The naira, one naira at that time was equivalent to about £1. You know, but at that time, the cost of Mercedes 200 was 5,000. Naira, so you know we can take the numbers, but you know the story is that really I paid him back his money, you know, within 3 months, because at that time the business was booming and you know I didn't really need capital because the business I had a lot of people paying and you know waiting at the same time. They pay for cement and wait for 6 months. Going forward, then we realized that really you know we had you know so much cash in 1996, and then we decided to call in Arthur Anderson then, you know, which is KPMG, Financial Services now, but then Arthur Anderson, and we asked them to look at what we need to do, because we had so much cash, and we had more cash than we could turn around, and they came up with that, okay, the best option for us is to do a backward integration and go into manufacturing, and but we were really a little bit scared of going into manufacturing, because manufacturing did not really do well in Nigeria at that time for the last 20, 30 years, which is normal really in an African country because of rampant changes of policies of government. When you wake up in the morning and say that, well, you know, there's no direction, the opposite way is the direction. So we decided that, okay, fine, you know, we will try and see if that will succeed. But what we did, you know, so that we don't really go into new markets, I mean new products, we started to, you know, do the products that we are well known for, you know, which is sugar, you know, flour, pasta, you know, all the ranges of things that we are doing. And we are building in various locations of Nigeria, almost about 13 different factories. And that is, I think, the one of the most challenging was, you know, our sugar refinery, which we agreed with one of the consumers, which is Nigerian bottling company, the franchise holder of Coca-Cola. And, you know, we now have started almost 13 factories, which we did eventually, you know, we did within 3 years, we finished all our factories. We started, because we had that mover advantage, we now realize that yes, you know, it was actually a big money-making decision. And then we decided now to start our terminal, you know, of cement to go and compete with the likes of Blue Cycle, that then, you know, Lafarge. And I remember in 2000, in November, there about when we were about to commission our factory. I think we developed a bit of cold feet that, look, is it really possible for a tiny little company like ours to compete with the likes of Lafarge that was established in 1894? And the answer was no. It would be very difficult. I think we should just go to Lafarge and give them, you know. At that time, they were, I think, trying to do the merger between Lafarge and Blue Cycle. We went to Lafarge, we agreed on all the terms, we are not going to do cement, we will not integrate, we will not do cement in Nigeria or any other country, and we will sell you know, them at a certain price. Why we didn't really agree was on the percentage. We agreed on management control to them, and you know, but we said 40%, they said no, 51%. But we said, well, you can take 40% with management, which means you can actually consolidate. And they said no, flat no. So we had no issue then to go back and think of what we were going to do. We couldn't go back to them and sell that to 1% because we went through a very difficult period by trying to build 13 factories at the same time. You know, we were really, you know, a bit tight on cash. And then we decided that, look, if we now go and sell majority shares to Lafarge, then it will confirm the story that yes, we are actually very tight on cash, and that is the decision why we sold the business. So we decided to compete with Lafarge, and when we started in December, it was tough, but within 3 months, we were able to get over the toughness of the business because we were really very determined, and we saw the opportunity, and you know, we started opening the second factory of cement in the southern part of Nigeria, in a place called Port Harcourt. Within 2 years, we took over 40% of the market. And it's been so for many years. That same company, at the time that we agreed to sell to Lafarge, and they didn't buy, they insisted 51%. Today, that company is worth almost 13 billion, you know, market cap. And you know, so now when we got there, we decided that okay, fine, since we have tested this business, it's doing very well. We now map the whole of Africa, mainly sub-Saharan Africa, and see that look, majority of these countries, they actually don't produce cement from limestone, right? It's, I mean, that's right from the beginning of the process. Majority, either they have a grinding mill, even while they have full production, it is all to do with, you know, just very old, 40, 50 years, you know, plant, which means they need to also make a new investment. So what we did now is to look at about 14 other African countries, within some of them within the sub-Saharan area, some of them within the, you know, but within that, you know, the sub-Saharan Africa, we went to countries like Liberia, Sierra Leone, Senegal, all the West African countries. Then in Central Africa, we are now in, you know, in Cameroon, Gabon, you know, Central, I mean, Congo, Brazil, not DRC. And that's where we are. Then East Africa, we are in South Africa, we are now in Zambia, Ethiopia, Tanzania. We are going to Mozambique, which is Central Africa.
So how much of your business is now outside Nigeria?